and welcome to today's segment of The Power of Money. I'm your host, Michelle Graves, nationally known as the Money Lady in the business of money and banking and finance since 1976, and bringing you people, information, and news that you cannot get any place else. I dare you to try it. But welcome to today's show. I'm delighted to have you on as a viewer, and as always, I have an amazing show for the next hour. So you just want to sit down and relax. If you're doing something, take a pause, because this is a really, really good guest today, and I'm honored to have her in the studios to talk about such a critical subject, and that subject is loving. Excuse me, please. Loving with a Purpose. And she is an author. Her name is Kimberly Mitchell, of this amazing book called Loving with a Purpose. And we're going to be talking on today's show with her and about the thinking about loving and understanding people and relationships. Viewers, did you know that it doesn't matter how smart you are if everybody thinks you're a jerk? Mm-hmm. Your kids hate you, the dog bites you. Your coworkers wonder, where did you come from? And I genuinely am excited about having her to talk about this very, very important subject. So again, take a seat, enjoy the broadcast, and I welcome you to my world today. And how are you today, Ms. Mitchell?
I'm good, thank you.
I'm so delighted to have you here to talk about loving with a purpose.
Loving with purpose.
Loving yes. with purpose.
Yes.
I do not normally read a book from cover to cover because I'm a speed reader and I am an alpha female. So yes. it's like, get to the finish, get to. But this book slowed me down and made me pause. So let's talk about the book. It goes without saying that anyone who's viewing this book and this interview should get the book. Where's the book available?
You can get it at Amazon.
On Amazon.com?
Amazon.com. You okay. can get it on my website, lovingwithpurpose.org.
Okay, let's say that again. And can you put that book up so we
sure.
can see this book for your viewers? Okay, so we can go to Amazon.com.
Mm-hmm.
Or we can go to
lovingwithpurpose.org.
Okay, Loving with Purpose, which is the title of the book.
That's correct.
.org. Okay.
Okay. You can go to some of the local stores in Cincinnati so far. I'm at a few of the Hallmarks.
Okay.
A couple boutiques.
Okay.
And I'm working on my way towards Dayton to get him out here as well.
Good. Well, there's a lot of people in Dayton that are faithful viewers and other markets of this show, and I just want to make sure, but they can always go to Amazon, or they can go to lovingwithpurpose.
That's correct.
.org.
That's correct.
Okay, great.
It's also an ebook.
It's an ebook as well,
that's
so you
correct.
Can download it as well.
That's true, yes.
Great. That's very, very right now for a lot of people.
That's true.
To help them. Well, let's talk about you.
Okay.
Because you cannot read this book without being aware that the lady that wrote this book had a story.
That's very true.
Let's talk about you, Kimberly, and mm-hmm. what provoked you to write this book.
Okay. Well, it started basically, I was in the corporate world for quite a long time. And from there, I moved to Florida for a couple years with my husband. And worked with a few iron workers, actually
okay.
quite a few iron workers.
Okay,
so
that's
I went,
hard hat.
Yes, it's definitely different from the corporate world.
Okay.
From there, we came back home, and I really wasn't sure what I wanted to do or what I was going to put my sights on until we went out to dinner one night.
Okay.
And I'm sitting there trying to think of, what is my purpose? What's my reason? What am I supposed to be doing? And I saw this older gentleman put his hand on the small of her back, his wife's, and escort her to the table. And like lightning, it hit me that is what I need to write about. I need to write about chivalry and about how men should treat women and how women should expect to be treated. And from that moment on, I just started writing.
So what moved you about seeing him escort his wife to the table?
Well, actually, because my husband does that to me. When he touches me on the small of my back and escorts me somewhere, it is just a very pleasing feeling to me. I feel special.
Okay, I would think so. That would be between a husband and a wife. That would be a communications piece, wouldn't it?
It's a small piece of just gratitude from him to me that makes me feel special as a woman, and that I am being taken care of, if you will, in the emotional, spiritual sense.
Okay, so your observation of this older gentleman exhibiting chivalry changed your world.
That's true.
And allowed you to look at this whole area of relationships?
That's very, well, yes. I thought that I would sit down and within 2 months I would have a book written, it would be off to the publisher, and it would be on the shelves.
Yes.
That's not the way it works.
Well, tell me about this journey.
It's a lot of research and a lot of trial and error. So as you go through, the first book I wrote was about 2 months. And then I started researching how to get it published. And that was quite a long journey, probably 6 months of just trying to determine, am I going to publish this myself? Am I going to go the traditional route? And what I also found is that if I write this book to men, chances are a lot of it isn't going to be read because men don't really read about relationships that often.
That's interesting. Men do not read about relationships.
As much as women.
As much as women. Probably because we're more nurturing.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And where I heard that was the man that wrote, I'm not sure of the name of the book, but he said it in the Sex and the City. He said, he's just not that into you.
And
they asked them, they said, why did you write this to women? He goes, because I wanted to sell more than two copies. So I switched everything around and then immediately went into 3 years of writing.
3 years?
Three and a half years to write this book. And that is learning how to do everything myself except using editors. I learned a lot about editing. I picked up my own artwork and then hired an artist to create it in the colors that I wanted it. And it just basically was a long process of learning and more so trial and error. Today I try to help other writers that are out there, and I just give me a call and let me talk to you and hopefully help you not go the same routes that I did and hopefully avoid some of that time.
I think a lot of people, and I've never written a book. I've been encouraged because my life is a very interesting life. But I've just seen so many people make big mistakes when they publish. I had a very prominent woman, and she put her blood into writing a book, got a top house, and the book did not go anywhere. And it was devastating, financially and otherwise. And then I've had some people just self-pub, and their writing is terrible. And I'm like, typos and content doesn't flow. So you went, and it actually took you 3 years to write this book. Then you had to learn how to publish it. Is that correct?
That's correct. That's
my correct. Goodness gracious. What did you learn in writing the book?
I learned a lot about myself.
Well, tell me about that.
Basically, I think that learning to love with purpose is a constant challenge for everyone. And my husband said that he even saw a difference in me because I started expecting more from him.
Really?
Yes. So although he was treating me well, I was started expecting more because I had convictions in the book of how a woman should be treated and how she should expect to be treated.
Well, tell me how a woman should be treated.
She should be treated with respect and she should be treated special. And the reason why I feel that, a lot of young women will not agree with that because they look at chivalry as a form of dependence.
Chauvinism or something.
Dependence, more so, I think. They feel that I don't need a man to help me. I don't need a man to do this for me. I can do it myself, which is very true. Women are very powerful and they can do for themselves. But there are a lot of women out there that are doing so much more when it comes to the home and the family and work, that I do believe that they deserve to be treated special. So when the man sends flowers, or he puts his hand on the small of her back, or he opens the door for her, women need to be appreciative of that and be okay with that. Mm-hmm. Because it's a man, you take away from a man when you don't allow him to do that. You expect more from him, which then grows him.
You know, that's interesting because I genuinely, and I'm a powerful woman and an alpha female and all that, but I love men to treat me
nice. Yeah.
My son was raised to open doors, to say yes, ma'am, mm-hmm. to be kind to women.
Absolutely.
And I really feel that despite, and then you hear men say, well, you know, you all want to be treated equally. I said, we want to be paid equally.
<That's>
Let's
right.
get clear. If I'm doing the work, I want the same pay. But the acts of kindness
shouldn't stop.
Should not stop.
They shouldn't stop. And they have so much. And I think that the biggest reason why I wrote the book is young people haven't been taught that. They haven't been taught to open the doors. They haven't been taught to just treat a woman with kindness. It's, you know, and then going back to the older days where a woman's work is in the home and she is to do all the housework, that's changed also. So
Right. When
it comes to equality, there's the other side of the coin. Yes, I want to be treated nice, but I also expect that you contribute
exactly.
to the family, to
exactly.
the home. So it's both sides of that
right.
equation.
Being, do you think men are getting that? That a woman, you can't turn a wife into a mule.
That's right.
You know, which is you're going to expect her to be a bread earner like you are. Birth children, we won't even talk about that. You know, like, uh-huh. And now you're going to be a homemaker and a cook.
That's right.
And so by the time nighttime arrives, you can't possibly expect a whole lot because she's exhausted.
And that's the key of the book, is it's not about what he expects, it's about what she expects.
Huh, so you flipped it.
I flip it to the point where it's not about, a woman needs to look at herself for the answers. If she's not getting what she needs from the person in her life, whether it be her husband, her boyfriend, her date,
mm-hmm.
her children, her boss, her coworker,
mm-hmm.
whoever it is, she has to look at herself as to why she's allowing that treatment. I always will go back to Dr. Phil's line, you teach people how to treat you.
Oh my goodness, let me say that again. You teach people how to treat you.
That's correct.
So if you're treated poorly, it's because that's the message you have sent out.
That is actually absolutely true, yes.
My goodness, do you find that to be true in all circumstances?
Yes, because here's how I would say you're at home and you're being abused.
Mm-hmm.
You are not responsible for what he's doing to you, but you are responsible for staying.
Right.
And so therefore you look to yourself for the answers mm-hmm. of how to resolve that.
So these are all choices.
These are choices that you make. And that's what I want to get with women, is you need to start looking at yourself. Instead of worrying about why he's not doing what he should be doing,
mm-hmm.
look at yourself and say, okay, well, that's not okay with me.
Right.
You need
to
expect
more. So do you think it's fear?
More.
Do you think women are fearful that if they become, that they make their spouses or significant others accountable, that they will wind up without that individual, that individual will say, I can't deal with this and leave? Do you think women are worried about being abandoned?
Oh, I'm certainly sure they are,
mm-hmm.
yes. I think they should be to a certain extent. But the thing is they have to decide what they can live with and what they can't.
Okay.
And, you know, if they want to stay in a marriage that's abusive, then they need to accept the fact that that is the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not going
to
change.
Yeah.
Absolutely. They're making
mm-hmm.
the choice to stay. And that goes for everything, as far as if you're dating someone and they are being judgmental of you in some way,
mm-hmm.
where you feel like they're not putting you in the highest light that they can,
mm-hmm.
you can choose to stay or you can choose to leave. The other option of that is not just those two choices. You choose
okay.
to walk at this point, but he also has a choice.
Right.
He may come after you,
mm-hmm.
and he may make the changes that are needed in order to have you in his life. I've seen
that's
it.
Good.
I've seen that over and over again in my life of people, you know, a guy's not doing what he should be, or he's doing something
mm-hmm.
he shouldn't be,
mm-hmm.
and she decides, I cannot do this.
I'm out of here.
And
mm-hmm.
they've made me firm believers that anyone can change as long as they want to.
Okay. So the change sometimes has to be the result of pain, perhaps?
Sometimes not. Sometimes it's as simple as you go on a date and he did not open the door for you, or he did not let you order first, mm-hmm. Or he has something about him that you just didn't like, mm-hmm. and you decide you don't want to go on a second date, at least not right now, mm-hmm. or you tell them the reason why you don't want to go on another date. Well, maybe sometimes you do. It really depends on the circumstance.
Really?
Yes. Sometimes it's a matter of just standing at the door and waiting for them to open mm-hmm. it. You're basically teaching him
how to treat
what mm-hmm. you expect.
Right, exactly.
And I think it's that simple. It's that simple.
Don't you think men are confused today?
Absolutely.
Because they don't know. I mean, here you got a liberated woman that wants you to step to the forefront and be a man, open doors, give her some level of protocol, and he's like, well, open your own door and pay your half of the bill. Mm-hmm. And so where do you draw the line, and is it about this whole issue of loving that other person?
Where do you draw the line?
Yeah.
It really depends on what you're talking about. If it's a matter, I'll give it for instance.
Okay.
There was a guy years ago that kept asking me to go on a date before I was married, of course. He begged me to go out, constantly asking me, please, let's mm-hmm. just go to lunch.
Okay.
Okay. On a normal situation, I may actually decide to go ahead and pay my half. I will at least go for my wallet.
Yes, right.
Okay. He allowed me to pay my own bill. After he begged me and begged me to go out with him, he allowed me to pay my own bill. I went for the money. He should have stopped me, in my opinion.
I think at the point he was
He was in pursuit of me.
And you were compliant to situation.
That's right.
And he did not pay the tab.
Right. It was only like probably $5, $10.
I wouldn't have cared.
I didn't go out with him again.
That's so interesting, though, because I had a situation, and I did terminate. And I don't say in. I terminated because I did have a gentleman that invited me to a restaurant that was outside of his budget. He made the choice to take me. He made the place, location, and then we got there, and he wanted to share my plate. And do you know what I did? Huh. I let him have the plate.
And you just sat there with...
No, I left.
Oh.
I left.
Okay.
I was like, I don't share food, and if this was out of your... And he said, Carla, he said, did you leave? I said, yeah, I did. I left because... there was a disconnect here. Mm-hmm. I don't share my food unless by consent. I mean, when my children were little, I shared plates and stuff. What mother doesn't? Kids mm-hmm. putting his hand in your plate. But I said, we're adults. And he said, well, it was a very expensive place. And I said, but you.
You chose it.
You chose it.
That's right.
You chose it. And that's just interesting.
I don't want to give the impression about money in this book.
This is a rich book.
I love
this book.
Thank you.
I have to tell you this. Like I said, there are some things. This one chapter, let's see if I can pencil you in.
That's all about work.
Yes. Yes. How do you learn to disconnect from work and engage in fulfilling relationships?
You have to actually make a purpose. You have to do that on purpose. Consciously, you have to make that choice to turn that phone off, mm-hmm. or you have to say, I'm sorry, I cannot make these appointments after such and such time because I'm going home to spend time with my kids and my wife or my girlfriend or whatever the
yes.
case may be. You have to make time for personal time.
Okay.
It's just you have to.
So how do you, and I ask this question because I am at the great age of 60 plus, I am making those choices now, which is people don't have access to me mm-hmm. just cause. And I had a dear friend who is a very well-known author, and she said, you should not be answering your cell phone whenever people call.
Mm-hmm.
Set types and times.
That's right.
And I'm learning. Do you find that to be helpful?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, I'll give a for instance in my personal life.
Okay.
My husband, since I started writing the book, I hadn't been working.
Okay.
And he would come home and then we would possibly go out to dinner. Well, his time, in my opinion, should be while I'm getting ready to go out and you've gotten home, make your calls then. Don't wait till you get in the car with me and make your calls, because This is supposed to be our time.
Our time, right.
And it's a simple request. That's okay. As simple as it can be. And the thing is he has to be conscious enough to realize what you're asking, you know, why you need this. Mm-hmm, and he has to put women, or his wife, or his date, and his children as a mm-hmm. priority. It's all about priority.
Important. Those priority issues, how does one, in this frantic world we're in today, and it is frantic.
It is frantic.
How does one prioritize? Is it based upon the heart, or what is it based upon? Because actually, when a person preempts you for a cell phone call, that's pretty significant,
right?
Wouldn't you say?
There's always going to be, for instance.
Okay.
You know, there's going to be a time when, for instance, my husband, he works at various times. His isn't just a 6-to-5 job.
Okay.
Or
right.
You know, there are times, especially because he works with people in the field. They're out on the job site, and then they turn around, they come home, or they're on their way home. Mm-hmm. That's when they can talk.
Right.
And that may be a 5 o'clock time or a 6
right,
o'clock
it
time.
Could be.
So you just have to adjust your time to a lot for that family time otherwise.
And other people begin to respect that.
Mm-hmm. So for instance, he may have from 4 to 5 to spend with me, but he's going to be on the phone from 6 to 8.
Gotcha.
So there's a time that mm-hmm.
but
it's
you
a
do have that downtime. That's
a conscious
decision,
choice,
right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely, you have to, or you get to where there are a lot of people out there that you have somebody that's a workaholic in the house that doesn't spend any quality time with their family. The other part of the family doesn't feel loved. Mm. And there's where divorce comes in, and split ups and breakups, because they're not feeling loved and they don't know
is
how to ask.
Is that really the issue? They don't feel loved for the most part?
I think when someone is so engulfed in their career life
mm-hmm.
and they want to have a relationship on the side, unless that other person is totally career driven also, they're going to feel left out.
Mm.
But the thing is that other person, for instance, I'm in the home.
Okay.
I cannot make my husband's job to take care of me and to satisfy me. I have to find that on my own as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
women that are in the home, what would you recommend if their husbands are, because there's a trade-off here.
Mm-hmm.
When you have a workaholic, incredibly successful husband, and you're reduced to feeling like a toy, because he does, you get money, you get benefits. I'm talking about women I know. There are benefits to that unlovely relationship. How does one adjust to that?
As far as being in the home all the
time? Yes,
yes. I've had to experience that myself.
Okay.
When we came home from Florida, I said, now what should I do now? I mean, I worked at P&G.
You
don't just walk in and say, I want to work here again.
Right.
And he said, just stay home. And I said, okay, sounds good to me.
Uh-huh.
And that lasted about 6 months.
And then what happened?
I had to find something. I wasn't okay with just being at home mm-hmm. and not having a reason for what I'm doing in life.
Okay.
And that is how I got to loving with purpose, to writing.
Goodness gracious.
Yes. And I mean, I've been writing my whole life, but not books.
Okay. What kind of books have you been writing?
I haven't been writing any books.
Okay.
Just poems.
Oh,
things,
okay.
Things
okay.
Through
just
my life.
Writing. Okay.
And what's
okay.
funny is I didn't realize that until I wrote this book. There's one girlfriend that I haven't seen in a long time.
Hmm.
She said, "Kim, I still have that frame that you gave me that's sitting in front of my treadmill. You know
really?
That you read that you wrote me that I had given her
yes.
as a gift, and
yes.
I forgot all about that."
That is wonderful.
You know, and somebody else from my high school years saying, "You always were somebody that would write." I never made the connection. You know what I mean?
Now, how do we transit from, because the big issue today, as I see it, is not just loving your spouse or your significant other, but children.
Mm-hmm.
Children. And my previous guest, awesome woman, Miss Neal, she touched on that, because we're in crisis with children.
We are, very much so.
And I have to believe at a core level, they don't feel loved.
I agree.
So how does one, with all of the hustle and bustle of this quote modern tech-driven society where kids, as I told one young lady, you're going to lose your mouth. God's going to remove, because you don't need it. You're just texting. Mm-hmm. You don't ever talk. She texts her mother. She texts her. She never talks. So how do you bridge that?
As far as spending time with your children?
Yes.
You make conscious efforts. That is why the book is called Loving with Purpose. Mm-hmm. Because when you go through your life and when you go through your relationships, you do things on purpose. That's the reason
for
the name.
So it's a conscious, deliberate.
It's a constant, conscious.
Proactive child decision, which is you will turn that text thing off.
You will turn the phone off.
We need to talk.
That's right. That's right.
We need to get to know each other.
That's
or,
right.
Or engage, something
and,
like
and
that.
And not just assume that it's okay. For instance, mm-hmm. we had our grandson yesterday.
Oh, nice.
He's sitting next to me. I'm on my phone texting. I look over, he's texting or he's playing a game. And my husband's on his phone across the room texting. I said, I just love family time. You know, and so you make it aware, everyone aware of it, mm-hmm, first off. Mm-hmm. And then you have to put those limits on the technology for all of you. I mean, it's a matter of when you're talking with someone. I was out with a friend on Friday, and she gets a call from her son, and she goes, I'm so sorry, that is so rude. She's conscious.
Right.
She's aware right. that there's a time where there should be interaction.
Right.
And you know, with children especially, they're not going to have the social needs that they to be able to speak with people, like you
not
said, they're going to remove
social skills.
Yes,
I mean
exactly.
they don't. One of my girlfriends is an educational consultant. She said, Michelle, the biggest issue I'm concerned about, they no longer know how to spell, mm-hmm. and many of them don't even know how to scribe.
Right,
they don't. These are tools that are passing by, and I told her that is tragic because the computer does not spell check well.
Right, right.
And when you're reading stuff, if you are a reader, you know mm-hmm. the thing missed the spell check.
Right, right.
And it looks really weird. So you say by making conscious, deliberate choices, you can change your outcomes.
Well, you can change the outcomes as far as family time.
Same
with the cell phones or the work environment. Mm-hmm. You know, a woman does, believe it or not, run the home.
Yes,
it doesn't
she does.
Necessarily always feel that way, mm-hmm. but hopefully she is the one running the home and she puts standards out there. We will have dinner at the table at 6 o'clock. If it's important to her
right.
to get the family together, this is what's going to happen. And this
right.
is what we need to do. And this is important to me.
But and, you know, and not to cut you off, Kimberly, because mm-hmm. I was a single mother and I, and of course an exec, but I did order my steps. I cooked all my meals on Sunday after I came home from church for uh-huh. the following week and froze them. And family time was critical for me mm-hmm. because my children were kind of like a balancing point to the craziness of corporate and business. And now you have children that want to download and talk. But as I look today, so many women, particularly women that are single, are pressed.
Oh, yes.
So how do you make those value judgments? How do you do that?
I consciously making those choices, realizing the one thing that I do know about myself is my son is 31 now.
My goodness,
yes.
My son's 31.
Yes.
Still a baby.
Yeah, still my baby.
Still your baby.
Still my baby, but I've watched him through the years. The thing I didn't watch and I wasn't conscious of is when I was a single parent, some of the things that he had to go through that
yes.
could have been better.
Yes. I take responsibility
I take
for that.
Responsibility
I
and I've apologized
yes,
for this, some of the
too.
Things I've done.
Yeah, me too.
Because I wasn't conscious.
Right.
You know, for instance, I didn't take him to church on Sundays. Mm-hmm. Why? Because he was with his dad. So that was my out.
Yes.
But it really wasn't my out. It was a choice that I made. I should have made a better choice when it came to that.
Well, how would you? If he's with dad,
I should have went on Wednesday.
Ah!
I should have went on Wednesday.
Okay, you Bible know, study, yeah.
But at the time in my life, it wasn't in my, mm-hmm, it wasn't mm-hmm. in my Sunday mm-hmm. ritual.
Right, right, right.
Do I regret it? Yes. Is he fine? Yes. Mm-hmm. Does he know God? Yes.
Yes.
But still the thing is, I could have given him so much more.
Right.
I could have given
right.
him the experience to do that. He was going with his father at times, or with his stepmother. Mm-hmm. But that still doesn't give me the out.
Right. Well, I think maybe a part of that reconnecting is recognizing that we were immature.
Mm-hmm.
And as I told my children, nobody writes a script for parenting.
They do not.
And you just kind of waddle your way through the mud, mm-hmm. and try to get it right, particularly in our generation. I know my age, and there wasn't a whole lot of support systems for single women.
Absolutely.
With children.
No, there wasn't.
Church as well. You know, the whole thing was you need to have a husband.
Right.
You know, you need to remarry. And you were like, but I need to feed my kids.
That's right.
I don't have time for this. But I see this, again, getting back on the subject of children. How can they collaborate with their mothers or fathers or parents to make their relationships more loving?
I had a friend who had a great idea that she did with her kids.
Okay.
And they would do the family dinner, but they would do a circle. And
okay.
It was mandatory. Everyone was there, her and her kids. And they would talk about things, and each person had to go around the table and talk. And that was the time to, you could say anything to her, to mom, and she would not get upset, she would not get mad, you wouldn't be in trouble. Just open your heart and open your mind and talk. And that way, they still do that with, some of them do that with their own children.
Oh, that's wonderful though.
So I think that's just one example of what you can do to open up with your children. It's amazing how much, when my son was probably 12 years old, and you know, I opened up a conversation about something, and I said, if you ever have any questions, if you ever want to talk about this, you just let me know.
Right.
And we always found it seemed like when we were in the car driving, that was a good time for us to talk. And surprisingly, he came right and started asking questions right then and there. So I think opening the dialogue of things that make us a little uncomfortable at times is all that's needed to get the child talking. Because a lot of times they either don't think of it, they don't think that you're the person to talk to, or they're afraid to talk to you because it's an uncomfortable conversation.
Well, I think a lot of them are operating under, they know us very well.
Mm-hmm.
Kimberly, they've watched us longer than we've watched them.
That's right.
And they do have some very good insights into our shortcomings.
Absolutely.
That may not feel so good coming out of the mouth of your child.
You just gave me chills on that one.
It's the truth.
I give a for instance on that is one thing that I didn't recognize when I was a young mother is that your children are listening.
Everything.
They are listening.
Yes.
And I watched this probably about 5 years ago as a mother was standing there talking about her ex-husband, the child's father.
Oh, boy.
And the little four-year-old was standing there next
mortified.
To a tree just looking at his mother and listening to, hanging on to every word.
Yeah.
And the thing was that she was me.
Right.
She was me.
Right.
I didn't realize that some of the things that I said or did were making a huge impact on my child.
Right.
More so than me.
Right. I think that's so wise what you just said. I counsel women often that whatever your bad times with your former, let it be just that.
That's right.
Do not bring your children as a listener to that experience, because
Absolutely.
That's too hard for a child to bear. It just is. They know they're connected.
It changes them.
It changes them in a very warped way.
Yes, it does.
And I think a lot of people need to time out, meaning stop it, because you're creating an environment where a child does not feel loved.
Absolutely.
And then they will go on and they will recreate the environment in their own lives. That they're familiar with.
Right.
Is that what you're thinking as well?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
There's no question about that. You know, I mean, they grow up and they become older and they do start making their own choices.
Boy, oh boy.
But up until that point, from the time they're, 15, 16, 17 years old up until something happens in their life, they're going on, they're just rolling with the flow.
Yeah.
They're just going by what they know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think the biggest thing a parent can do, if you have parents listening and they want to know what, I feel so bad for what I've done to
mm-hmm,
this date.
Mm-hmm.
Best thing you can do is go to your child, apologize.
And just tell them
apologize.
Sorry. And tell them you were stupid.
Tell them I'm sorry.
I'm
stand up for what you
yes.
did wrong. Be accountable. Because you take it off the child's shoulders when you do that.
That is so powerful what you just said about a parent saying to their child that I am so sorry and forgive me.
Forgive me for what I've
done. For what I've done, and what do I need to do to make it right?
That's
because
right.
Because at the point a child sees a parent willing to acknowledge their vulnerability, willing to embrace transparency on such a personal level,
mm-hmm.
and the willingness to ask the child, what can I do to restore
right.
and to make it right? I think that's tremendously healing.
I believe so too.
I really do.
Because you have to think about like when a divorce happens.
Yes.
Everybody has heard that the child takes it on as what have I done wrong?
Yes.
Well, that's everything that when you call your child, say brat.
Yes.
Or anything that you've ever done, you've yelled at them or this or that or the other. Of course, we're all human and things are
mm-hmm,
gonna happen.
Mm-hmm.
But when you apologize for it, you take that name, that title of brat or maybe mm-hmm. you have said, you take that away from them and you put it on you.
You know,
and I just think it's a lovely thing when that happens.
I particularly as I look around, and like I said, I'm in the grocery stores and out and about, and I watch women and men and their children. I watch this now. It's funny, as I'm older,
yeah.
I watch how they deal with their children, and I absolutely tell people, do not, unless they are killing somebody, do not call your children out of their name.
Right.
Do not ascribe animal characteristics to your child.
Absolutely.
And begin to see your child as an extension of yourself.
Absolutely.
And what you see in the end is what you get.
That's right.
So if you treat them badly, that's exactly what you got coming.
That's right.
Down the road. And I know with a lot of younger women, they don't see it like that because they're young.
Right, I was there.
I never ever, my children said what irritated them, they talk about it as family. They said, Mom, when we messed up, Mom wanted to take us out to breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And let's talk about this. And then she'd bring her little Bible. And let's see what God has to say. And they were like, we were bad. We don't want to know what God said.
I'm going to go home feeling bad.
You're feeding us and you're talking about, let's see what God said about this behavior. They're like, oh gosh, this is bad. This is really bad. So we laugh about that, but I've also felt that it has helped to shape and mold their view on sitting down and trying to work things through.
Right. Right. That's a good thing.
Yeah. But they talk about, they said, God, my daughter said, I took my mother's diamond to school. And she did. And I thought I had lost it. And my 3-carat diamond was at her school, and her teacher had a seizure. And so when I said, oh no, we have to talk about this. She's like, no, we don't. We don't have to talk about this because I already know the end. Thou shalt not steal.
Yeah.
But on the subject of that, what have you learned about the character issues as we look at your exploration in this loving? And for those of you just tuning in, we're talking about Loving with Purpose, a new book that has been published by Kimberly Mitchell. It's available on Amazon.com and other venues. But I'm interviewing her, and we're just having a great conversation about how to love. Everybody wants to be loved, but so few people actually know how to love. So anyway, continuing on, as we were saying.
Okay, and you were talking about the characteristics of...
Yes.
I wasn't sure what you were talking about.
Well, we're talking about, because people, do you think that character plays a lot with the issue of loving, authentically?
A person having character?
Yes.
So
how do you know this thing? How do you know a person lacks character until you're in the midst?
The first thing that comes to mind for me is the thing that I see a lot of these days, which is entitlement.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that a lot of people, I think people in general, need to go through things in order to be able to appreciate the other side. In other words, you might have to go through that bad divorce, or you might have to go through that bad relationship, mm-hmm. or get your heart broke, or do without something,
mm-hmm.
do without things,
mm-hmm.
in order to, once you get those things, or you get that perfect person in your life, you realize how fortunate you are. And to me, that's a bit of what I would describe as having character.
Okay. Humility, perhaps.
Humility,
yes.
Being humbled.
Yes.
I think that does help build character. I really do.
Mm-hmm.
I think my parents did a very good job of giving me character for various reasons.
Well, that generation.
Yes.
That's the war generation.
Well, we, right. Yes, and we, you know, I look at like what my parents did for me is they didn't give me everything.
No, they didn't.
I had to work for it. And to me, that gives me pride when I get something accomplished like this book.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
I worked very hard at it. And so I'm very grateful that I'm here with you today.
Oh, it's a delight.
And that I'm in the stores and that I'm on Amazon. I'm grateful that it's finished.
Mm-hmm.
It was a long journey, a lot longer than I expected.
I don't know. I think timing is everything. Are your parents still alive?
My father is. My mother's
okay.
gone.
Okay.
My mother's
Has gone. He had a chance to read the book?
I don't know if he read it or not, to be honest. My stepmother, I believe, has read it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I believe so. With men, this would be...
It's a tough read.
It's a tough read because they got to sit still.
That's one of the reasons why there's pictures inside the book is to help with visuals.
Yeah, I love it.
But what's interesting is this book is written to girlfriends. I wrote it girlfriend to girlfriend is how I wrote it.
Okay.
But I've heard from 17-year-olds to 66-year-old males.
About this book.
Who have read this book. I still have a voicemail from a man who lost his wife after 40 years.
Uh-huh.
And after she passed, he started on the dating scene after 40 years.
Oh,
you can
boy.
Imagine
that
how
is
difficult
got
that
to be
is.
Difficult.
And I still have his voicemail. I'll never get rid of it,
mm-hmm.
because of all the nice things he said about the book and how well written it was,
mm-hmm.
and
it
how
is
much
well
he
written.
Got from it.
Mm-hmm.
And now he's on the dating scene. He's off and running.
Is he?
As far
how
as the
do
dating.
You? How does one date authentically with internet?
I think that the way you have to do that is that's a start.
It's just
that's a
screensaver.
I believe it's a start. Yes.
Okay.
It's a start. You know, I believe that Match.com and all that can work.
Okay.
I think even online dating can work,
mm-hmm.
to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm.
It can work a little bit because of the video portions of that.
Yeah.
But ultimately, there has to be a meeting, not just of the minds and of the face, but
mm-hmm.
of the heart and
mm-hmm.
the touch. You have to have the whole package to see if it'll work.
Okay.
But with internet, I think, you know, women have been going out to bars for years to meet men.
This is true.
Today, you can go on the internet and you can go through a lot more faces and a lot
mm-hmm.
more profiles without having to go and sit in a bar, you know,
mm-hmm.
or go to church.
Mm-hmm.
You can go to different venues. You can start with the internet. You go out there, you have these fast 15-minute meetings.
Yeah, speed dating.
Speed dating,
yeah.
Or
yeah,
or just,
mm-hmm.
you know, I did Match.com before
okay.
I met my husband. And what
Does it work?
I didn't meet my husband at Match.com, but here's what it did do for me. I went on about six different 15-minute, half-hour
mm-hmm,
dates,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and it taught me what I didn't want.
Ah,
so
okay,
I dated
I
a couple guys that were,
mm-hmm.
one from Dayton actually, that we would meet for dinner, and lovely man, lovely.
Okay.
I knew he wasn't for me, but he was a lovely man.
He's a
man
nice
to,
guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I did learn what I didn't want.
Okay.
And some of the things that I did want, there was the guy from Dayton, he was a great guy. He
mm-hmm.
just wasn't for me, but he was a
right.
great guy. And I've always believed that if you go out with someone and they treat you a little special,
mm-hmm.
he has just raised your standards.
Yes, he does.
He may
you
not
cannot
be.
Go, you're right. He may not be the one, but.
You won't go back lower.
You won't go back lower.
That's
right.
What
I tell my daughters. I said, boy, once you have met a gentleman.
Absolutely.
You will not ever do scrubs again.
That's right.
It's just
right.
not going to happen. It really isn't. So as we look at our changing society, And we are seeing more and more people in my generation who are not only divorcing, but starting out with new lives. They've realized over the course of their marriage that it never was happening. And now their children are gone, and they realize it just isn't happening.
Mm-hmm.
So you're now finding people that are doing reassessments.
Absolutely.
Is this something that could help them as well?
Absolutely. Yes, it would.
Now tell me how.
Well, for instance, if you're not a gentleman, you should be.
And how do you learn that?
I think that's pretty easy to learn. I think it's a matter of a man expecting more from himself.
Okay, so and he becomes a better man.
That's right.
Okay.
And that's why with the book, when I talk to women, expect things. Expect what's important to you. Maybe opening a door isn't important to you.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that has nothing to do with what makes you tick.
Mm-hmm.
But whatever does, expect it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not getting it, figure out a way to get it.
Right.
And if he's not the one that's going to give it to you, then either he's not interested enough to change or he can't change. It
Do
is
you
the
think
way.
People can't change? There are some people that simply can't change?
Depending on what they've been through themselves, some people probably can't. But it's, I think, honestly, it goes back to can.
Yes.
You know, it's a matter of they may think that they can't. I mean, how many of us have walked around with the word can't in our vocabulary?
Oh, that negativity, yeah.
Right. The negativity can just destroy you.
Right.
And so ultimately they can, but they may not be able to see that for themselves. And if they can't see that for themselves, you can't make that happen. You know, I talk about that in a few sections in the book, you know, as far as you've got to be able to open yourself to realize that, for instance, I dated someone that was very judgmental. Well, that's
when you say judgmental, what does that mean?
For instance, I was making a Thanksgiving dinner one night, you know, and I very rarely made Thanksgiving dinner. And, you know, I'm dating him, but the last thing at 35 years old, do I need you to call your mother to find out how to make this turkey? You know, and
oh, no.
And then telling me what I'm doing wrong.
Oh, you, no.
No, I don't need that.
Because now he's going to make the turkey.
I don't need that. Right. So that's just one simple thing. But if that is his personality.
Right.
Somebody that, for instance, likes to bicker
right.
back and forth, regardless.
Oh, my goodness, yes.
You
and
know
there
what I
are
mean?
People like that.
Yeah, they just like to argue.
They just do.
They like arguing
leave
points.
Leave me alone.
Mm-hmm.
Go
it's tiring.
On somebody else.
It's tiring.
Yeah.
It's very
yeah.
tiring. You don't always want to have to say yes when they're saying no or vice versa.
Uh-huh.
So.
Or even, as I was sharing with one individual, I said it's perfectly acceptable to have a different opinion.
Mm-hmm.
But it does not mean a war.
Right, like politics is
these
not, days.
I don't like getting involved in those kinds of things if it doesn't profit.
Right.
Meaning you have your opinion, I have mine. Can we agree to disagree?
Absolutely.
Put it on park and keep moving.
That's right. Yes. I talk about that under politics.
Yeah,
in the
I
book.
Love that. That was a great, great section. That
yes.
was great. Can you ever win talking about politics?
I don't know about that.
I don't either.
I try to refrain from it, and you know, I'm out on Facebook quite a bit, and you see all these things. I've watched how the conversations go, and that's why I honestly believe that there should be no parties. You just stand on, here's my list of things that I believe, these are the things I don't believe.
And either...
Everybody go vote.
Right.
And I just see so much hatred in the conversations.
Well,
that
it triggers, Kimberly, it triggers a button. And the button is, as I tell people, since I've, you know, been in politics, I have political friends on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
And find myself irritated a lot, so I don't want to talk about it. But I say to people, can you let your politics be known when you vote?
Yeah.
Just vote. And it's done.
Right.
You know, whatever your decision, it's such a personal thing, and I have seen it destroy relationships.
I have too.
Have
to.
You seen that?
Yes, yes. Well, it could have.
Yeah.
Had I not just
said, I can't.
You know, because I've had conversations with people, and they're, you know, they're firm in their beliefs.
Yeah.
And
fine.
That's okay.
Fine.
And I don't even mind the debate a
right.
little bit. But there's a point where I stop it. And right. I don't want to talk about it anymore because it's not doing anything for me.
Well, I think that's such a powerful piece in your book where it's not doing anything for you.
Right, it's not.
And you always leave those conversations feeling grimy.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about your experience, but at one point I was on talk radio quite a bit, and I did have politicians as friends on it. And they could say whatever, but they will say, Michelle was like, you're not dragging me in the sewer, buddy. I'm not coming there with you. And it was okay because if I didn't see the benefit to my own account, then I just made a choice. Mm-hmm. And I look at people in relationships, and I really think that can be a killer. Politics can be a killer. Mm-hmm. Unless you're a politician,
right,
arguing with another politician.
Mm-hmm.
But I do not think in loving relationships, addressing those kinds of things does not add one point to your side.
Right.
Of the road. I don't think so.
No, I don't think so either. I've actually, with a personal relationship that I have, mm-hmm. I had made the decision, the conscious decision, I'm not going to argue politics with anyone.
Right.
I'll talk about issues,
right,
but I will not argue about
right.
it, and I will not get overheated about it. And I can,
right.
you can sit there on the phone or in person, and you can watch that other person as you're disconnecting from it.
As you're disconnecting.
Disconnecting.
If they watch your body language, you're moving this way.
But watch them.
Oh.
Look at them and how heated they're getting and how
I'm
their
like,
blood
what?
Pressure's going up. And you can see them literally,
yeah.
you know, stressed.
Right.
And,
right.
and you realize, I don't want to be that person.
No.
I don't want to be that person.
No. I will not, in the same wise as I tell, I do not touch religion,
mm-hmm.
even though I'm a woman that loves Jesus Christ. That is my belief system. I do not argue or debate with other people's belief systems.
Right.
Because religion cuts into the soul, and that's a touchy subject
mm-hmm.
for most people. That's a touchy subject.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to take care. Any other thoughts? Because believe it or not, our hour is almost up.
Oh my goodness.
I told you.
It doesn't
yes,
feel like
only
it.
A few minutes. So is there any final things you want to say about this amazing book? Other than it's a wonderful book.
I just think that it can help women and men, both. I am working on my second book.
Are you a sequel to this?
A sequel to that,
oh,
but
good.
It's for men.
Okay.
But again, I think men can get a lot out of this.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest message I would say is that this book is to talk to women. It, no matter what I talk about, whether it be religion, politics, discrimination, children, blended families, foster parents.
Oh, yeah, that's
all
another
of it.
Show.
That's
blended
another
families,
show.
You know?
It always goes back to her.
Yes.
And I hope that women out there everywhere will get something out of it that they can take to their relationships and make their man feel special while he's making them feel special.
Well, I must be candid with you. I don't have a man or a woman or anybody. I have been on a work path for years. As my children said, Mom needs to get a life. And I told them,
that is your life.
That is my life. I'm happy. But I will say this because it enabled me to see quite a few things about myself
mm-hmm.
that I wanted to make some change moves about. And one of them was the area of balance.
Mm-hmm.
Because I respect happy relationships. I like to see couples that are happy and that enjoy each other. And I believe that the potential rests in all human beings to have those kinds of relationships. I really do. So on that note, I just wanted to say for those of you that are watching, I encourage you to get this book, put this as a part of your library. It will help you to readjust your priorities, to value the significance of others, and learn how to love yourself authentically, not with the spills that I'm seeing so much bantered around today about, you know, I love me and all that. I'm talking about an inside head job, learning how to not only love yourself, but also how to love and be respectful of others. That's very important to me, and I know with my guest today, Kimberly Mitchell, author of Loving with Purpose, this is also very important with her as well. So I'm going to end today's show on a very positive note. Learn to love you, learn to be respectful of yourself, and learn to be respectful of others and honor them. You be blessed today, and I look forward to you being a part of my next segment on Michelle Graves, The Power of Money. Take care.